Hello, and welcome to our very first lecture, Chapter 1, What is Microeconomics? Seems like a reasonable place to start a class. Let's figure out what it is that you're about to study. Of course, there would be multiple definitions of microeconomics, but in general, it's going to come down to something along the lines of it's the study of how households and firms make decisions when they interact in markets and how the choices of households and firms will be influenced by government policy. Sometimes the government's intentionally trying to influence their actions, sometimes it's unintentional. In a true market economy, you would have just households and firms. We live in a world where we have households, firms, and government, and they call that a mixed economy. So what are these decisions they're making? Certainly it's about buying and selling. It's about how much to produce, what price to sell it at, how much to buy, what price to pay for it, those sorts of decisions. And as these decisions are being made by the buyers and sellers, they're having to face a unpleasant reality that their resources are scarce. And so since we don't have an infinite amount of everything we could possibly want, we have to make decisions of how to use things. We use it one way, we can't use it another. And that's what we mean by the allocation of our scarce resources. How do we decide what to use the iron ore for? And once we've used it, right? So how do we make those decisions? And the study of that, of course, is microeconomics. Coming into scarcity a little bit more, because it really is the root of economics. We would not have economics without scarcity. So what is it? A good definition of it is unlimited wants meets limited resources. The idea is we all, producers, consumers, whatever group we're looking at in the economic world, we all have unlimited wants, but we have to decide which ones we can actually satisfy because our resources are not unlimited. You can prove this quite easily to yourself. You can make a list of things that you would like to buy right now, and I have a feeling that list is going to be a little bit longer and a little more expensive than your current resources, your budget, would allow. So we're all dealing with this idea of these unlimited wants meeting limited resources. And I do mean we all are. Even if you think if you're the richest person in the world, you still have scarcity because it's not just about money. It's about all resources, which would include time. And when you have a certain amount of time, when you've chosen to do an activity like come to this class and spend an hour working on this class, you are giving up anything else you could have done with that time. And that's what we're looking at here in economics. We're looking at the fact that because scarcity exists, scarcity is an always existing, ever-present condition of the world we live in, that when you make decisions to use your time a certain way, use your money a certain way, then you are by definition facing a trade-off. You're giving up the option of using that money and that time some other way. And the technical term for giving that up or for valuing what you gave up in economics is what we call opportunity cost. So by choosing something, you have to then be not choosing something else, right? You spend an hour here, you don't have it available elsewhere. You spend your money going out to eat, then you don't have the money available to pay for, I don't know, new shoes that month. Not the same money, at least. And so technically, the way we actually value opportunity cost is out of all the various options you'd have of, you know, alternative uses of your time, alternative uses of your money, there's something that's the best second option, the best next best option. Whatever that value is, that's truly your opportunity cost. We're going to see more about opportunity cost in chapter 2, but it's a fundamental part of economics because it's coming naturally from scarcity. And one last thing here. It's important to note at this point, even though it won't totally make sense yet, that scarcity is not shortage. Shortage is a term I'm sure you've heard of before. It means obviously not having enough of something. It sounds very similar to scarcity, but it's not. They actually are two very different terms. And so as we get through to chapter 3 and 4, I think we'll see more clearly exactly what shortage is. But let me just point this out. Scarcity always exists. Scarcity exists because we live in this imperfect fallen world. Presumably heaven would have no scarcity. We would have everything we could possibly want, an abundant of of resources, or maybe our wants are low, but whatever it is, we wouldn't have scarcity there. And you know what? You wouldn't have economics. So there's no economics in heaven. I'm not exactly sure what that means about my profession. However, keeping on with it, we are not in heaven. We are here on this world where we do have unlimited wants facing our limited resources. So scarcity exists at all times. You can have market equilibrium and you still have scarcity because there were decisions made of how to allocate your resources to get to that point of equilibrium. A shortage is a market out of equilibrium. It's just a temporary condition that the market will fix itself if it's allowed to. All right, what is a market? As long as I'm talking about markets, it's really just a group of buyers and sellers coming together to trade goods and services. It's also would be the institutions or whatever arrangements are being put together so they can come together and trade with each other. As I said at the very beginning, a market economy is the term you would use for a system where it's just buyers and sellers making the decisions which allocates all our resources, whereas a mixed economy also brings in a thing called government that makes decisions, affects the rules, and therefore can affect the decisions the households and producers are making. And we live in a mixed economy. So we will talk mainly about market economy, but when we get to a chapter where we talk about taxation, obviously that's bringing in the mixed economy. But when you're looking at a market transaction that's just involving a buyer and seller, it really doesn't matter at that point if it's market or mixed. We will be focusing on that decisions of the buyer and the seller. Another fundamental important point of microeconomics is a concept called voluntary exchange. And basically, as long as I was just talking about government, government is usually about involuntary exchange. Government is the only entity that can command something to happen. So they can command you to pay taxes even though you may not voluntarily want to pay it or to do other sorts of rules and regulations. But when we're looking at buyers and sellers interacting in a market, we're talking about voluntary exchange. And that's very important to understand the concept of what we're saying here. You're only doing it because you want to. So allocations in the market are considered efficient because all decisions are based on voluntary exchange. No buyer or seller would agree to a transaction that makes them worse off. It's not rational to do something that you know is going to make you worse off. So you wouldn't do it. And that means that anytime we see an actual transaction occur, that it must have improved the allocation of resources. So if you sold your car for $4,000, it means by definition that you preferred the $4,000 to the car, even if you would have liked to have more, you still agreed to it. So $4,000 means more to you than the car, and the buyer, of course, values the car more than the $4,000. If that wasn't the case, there wouldn't have been a sale. And so that's what we mean by voluntary exchange. So if a market is considered efficient because of voluntary exchange, what do we mean by efficiency? Could be two different types of things. One is productive efficiency. The term production, producers, production is a good or service being produced at its lowest cost. And producers have the incentive to do that because they want to maximize their profit. So they're going to look to minimize their costs. But there's another kind of efficiency, which is that the answer to what goods and services should be produced is when it's the optimal ones, the one that people most want to buy, that's considered allocative efficiency. And the reason producers have an incentive to achieve allocative efficiency is they do actually want to sell what they produce. So they are actively seeking what will best sell when they make their decision of what to produce. And so what we're saying here is the market economy is naturally bringing itself to these levels of productive efficiency and allocative efficiency. All right, another concept that's very important to understand if we're going to introduce economics is marginal analysis. The idea is that when our producers and sellers or consumers are making the decisions of how much more to buy, how much more to produce, they're looking at what we call the margin, the last unit consumed, the last unit produced. So from here on, when you see the term marginal, just mentally translate it to additional, because marginal is not, in the way we use it, is not used this way in normal English. So just translate it to additional, you have a better shot of understanding at what we're trying to convey. So one of the terms you'll see is marginal cost. You can instantly see that as the additional cost of the last item produced. What was the additional dollar amount? You know, we have a total cost, we know how much it costs to produce everything. The producer's thinking about, what if I made one more unit and it costs $25 to make just that one more unit? Well, that would be the marginal cost. There's also on the consumer side something called marginal benefit, which is the additional benefit of the last item consumed. It could be revenue if they're measuring it in dollar terms, but marginal benefit could be a general term of happiness, utility, satisfaction as well. And so what we see then in economics that the optimal allocation of what amount should be produced and what amount will be bought is the quantity where you have marginal benefit equal to marginal cost. And so that's basically what we'll be coming to repeatedly throughout the semester, particularly as we get to the later chapters, we'll see that marginal revenue equals marginal cost. So to wrap up this particular lecture, our little introduction here, economics is simply the study of choices simply because scarcity means you can't have everything. Even the richest person in the world faces scarcity of time. All products should be produced at the output level where marginal benefit is equal to marginal cost. And that simply means that the last unit bought by the household is going to give the same amount of additional benefit as its additional cost. If you produced at a lower level of output, the marginal benefit of that lower level output, that last unit produced, will be higher than the marginal cost. And that's just a market signal that, hey, people really want this, and that'll signal to producers to produce more. And if they were producing more than that, it would be the flip side, the additional enjoyment and value of that last unit is lower than marginal cost. And that's a sign that there's too many resources making this particular product. All right, well, that'll wrap it up for our intro. Thank you very much.